Now, Rajas has a place in giving us vitality, energy, and movement. But if we want to make it into something positive, we need to ally the energy of Rajas with the quality of Sattvaguna, the receptivity, the peace, the harmony, the balance, the selflessness. I mean, it's good to be able to accomplish something, but what are you doing it for? If you are doing it just for yourself personally, it doesn't have a whole lot of meaning. So first of all, we do something for our family. So by that, we're already introducing some aspect of sattva into the rajas. And then we work on a greater level for the society and for the spirituality. Then we ally the rajas with the sattva. So the gunas teach us how to take our human success and expand it into something that is meaningful and helpful for other human beings and for the planet as a whole. Now, at the same time, the gunas help us show how to work in the world. For example, we have to work with different people. We will find there are sattvic people, very nice, mild, spiritual. There are rajasic people who are very aggressive, who can be very strong, who can be very talented, who can be very successful. There are tamasic people who don't want to work, who have inertia, who have resistance. And we all, each one of us, have the three gunas. So we will have our times when we're more perceptive, receptive, more sattva guna. We have our times when we're more aggressive, energetic, agitated, more guna of rajas. We have our times where we have more inertia, we want to sleep, we're tired, we need to withdraw. We have more the guna of tamas. So the gunas also understand not only different human types, but also different phases we are all going through so that we can make the maximum positive usage of these phases. If someone's under the guna of tamas, we're not going to push them too hard. If we're in a mode of rajas, we're going to make sure that we'll do our work, be active at that particular time. If we're in the mode of sattva, then we want to be able to stay in that and have a more peaceful and meditative time. So the gunas help us understand human behavior, and they help us understand the phases and the movements of our lives. They also help us understand the values, the positive aspects, but even the limitations of the culture that we have. The psychology is a very important factor relative to the gunas. The whole of the Hindu thought and the Ayurvedic psychology, the yogic psychology, is based on cultivating sattva guna. It's felt that if we have more sattva guna, if we have this ability to be meditative, to be perceptive, to be open, to be loving, to be caring, then we will have peace of mind, we will have internal happiness, contentment, and we will be able to help others as well. The Western psychology also has some regard for the sattva guna. It may not formulate it consciously the same way. But the Western psychology has mainly arisen to deal with the problems in the subconscious mind, to deal with what are called, you know, repressed issues, traumas, experiences from childhood, addictions, and even very disturbed mental states. These are generally in the realm of tamas, something that is hidden, dark, you don't want to face, you don't want to remember. And so a lot of the Western psychology is concerned with bringing out these memories, making us re-experience them, helping us understand what happened to us in childhood, emotional traumas, abuse, going through and releasing the energy in that. So we could say that is a movement from tamas to rajas. In the process, the person is able to regain energy, regain confidence, get a better self-image, better self-empowerment, motivation to do things, ability to go out in the world, achieve things, and do things. So we would say most of the Western psychology is aimed at moving from tamas to rajas. And we accept that from the Hindu thought as well. If there's tamas there, you need to first of all go into rajas. Even say, for example, on a physical level, if you have a lot of inertia, you've been sitting around all day, you have to go out and exercise, move, run, which is rajas. But to reach the higher levels of consciousness, we have to move from rajas to sattva. We have to go beyond just our own personal success into a greater selflessness and willingness to help others. And this sattva guna also can help the psychology, because there are people who have psychological unhappiness, even if they're successful, they have money, their work has gone well, but because they still feel there's something, they need something more, must be some greater meaning in life. So a complete psychology will help us eliminate the tamas, the inertia, the ignorance, the addictions, the repressed negative feelings, develop rajas in a positive sense so that we are able to work, communicate, express ourselves, be a person, be an individual, but also be willing to go to sattva. So even if we've done all this in success in the material world, we're still willing to do charity, to help others, and inwardly to seek a higher truth, to meditate, to practice yoga, to follow a spiritual path, to open up to the higher reality beyond the ordinary sphere of just human work and achievement, however helpful that is in its own place. So I think if we put these two psychologies together, they can be helpful, and together they can show us how to not only go beyond our ordinary human problems, but to open up a higher dimension of spirituality, creativity, and enlightenment. What happened to me in my life that brought me in touch with these spiritual teachings, including the gunas? Well, I grew up in the late 60s, in which there was a new interest in spiritual things, in things from India. You know, you had the Beatles, you had the Beach Boys, you had Maharishi Mahesh Yogi. So in that generation, I came into contact at a fairly young age with Eastern spiritual teachers and teachings, the teachings of Paramahansa Yogananda, the teachings of Sri Aurobindo, of Ramana Maharshi, the practice of yoga, the teachings of Vedanta. I think ours was the first generation in which these teachings were fairly commonly available to people. You know, I was born in 1950, to people who were in their late teens, early 20s, and college era. And many people got into those teachings as a kind of fad at that time. I remember going, there were yoga classes where thousands of people would attend even then. And at that time, there was more interest in the spiritual aspect of yoga. There were many teachers who were coming over from India. So in that context, I became aware of various spiritual teachings. In fact, at that time, I tried to study all the main spiritual teachings of the world. But the main teachings that interested me were the teachings of yoga and the Vedanta. And studying yoga, the three gunas are part of the philosophy of yoga. Yoga as a spiritual practice is about the cultivation of sattva guna. That is everywhere in the yoga teachings. Yoga is about developing that quality of harmony, balance, contentment, stillness, equanimity at a physical level. You know, that is actually the purpose of the yoga asana. So I learned the value of these teachings. I came into contact with different teachers, first in the United States, later on in India. I perhaps took these teachings more seriously. I learned Sanskrit gradually, and over the course of time, I gradually deepened my study over a course now of well over 30 years, dedicating myself to that. As for what was the cause or what triggered that in me, I think I had a kind of natural, mystical, and poetic urge when I was growing up. You know, I used to write poetry, I studied different mystical teachings. But I think it was the contact with the great gurus of India, reading about figures like Paramahansa Yogananda, and realizing that these were people who were still alive, who were still contemporary. And they had given us practical teachings, not just philosophy, not just theology, not just ritual or prayer, but also practical teachings, mantra, meditation. And I think one of the decisive things is I learned the form of meditation from the Self-Realization Fellowship when I was probably about 19 years old. I had taken their lessons and all of that. And as I did that meditation, their Kriya Yoga, it developed a lot of inner experiences for me. So I could then experience in my own mind and consciousness that yes, there were broader states of awareness. Yes, there were deeper levels of consciousness. Yes, we can communicate to the divine, to the gurus at an inner level. So having that inner experience through the meditation and developing that inner experience through ongoing meditation, pranayama, yoga practices has allowed me and helped me continue in this process of inner discovery. How has understanding the psychology and spiritually of the gunas affected me as a person? Well, first of all, it's helped me understand what I'm doing. You know, what forces am I putting in motion in my life? If, you know, once we understand the gunas, you know, once I learned to understand what rajas is, then I realized that if I was spending my time being too active, too outgoing, too much involved in external stimuli, you know, too much involved in parties, too much involved in watching programs, too much involved in getting my sense of being from the outside, going after other people, moving around, that I couldn't develop that inner stability. So understanding the guna of rajas helped me understand that to really find that inner peace, to really find the inner happiness, requires a cultivation more of stillness, of non-action, not necessarily always doing something. You can often accomplish more by not doing something, by waiting for the proper moment to do something. So understanding of rajas helped me reduce that quality inside myself and also let go. At the level of rajas, we think that we have to do everything ourselves. You know, I have to save the world, I have to be the perfect person, I have to make all the money, I have to learn everything. And this is accomplished through external activity, through making myself do more. When we understand the quality of the sattva-guna, then we realize that we can do more often by letting people be who they are, by being receptive to other people, by learning their strengths and helping cultivate them. So as I began to understand the gunas, it helped me let go of a lot of the stress, the anxiety, the need to achieve, the need to accomplish, a lot of the ego drive that we have in the Western world. The understanding of the guna of tamas helped me understand it's best not to, you might say, put everything aside and wait. It's best not to get involved in inertia. Be active, be decisive, have a positive movement in your life. Don't get caught up in depression. Don't get caught up in negativity. Don't get caught up in the influence of the past, trying to rectify what happened before. Be willing to let things go. So I learned to see how the negative gunas, the rajas and tamas, were blocking me in life, and also see how to use them in a positive way, and how to cultivate the sattva guna, because the sattva guna also requires understanding rajas and tamas, and it's also said to be the balance of rajas and tamas, has the stability of the tamas, but the dynamic energy of the rajas. So to be dynamic in stillness, to be stable in action, to be able to meditate and perceive, but to be able to do, accomplish, and have a positive effect upon the world. To be able to practice these things, you need a lot of self-discipline, of course. And what do we do to achieve these things, to have these higher results, to have this sattvic approach? Well, first of all, we do need allies. We do need friendship, we do need the alliance of other people, spiritual people, like-minded people. In the Hindu thought, we put a great emphasis on the principle of association.